Good evening. My name is Paul White from Communications Services Manitoba. Manitoba is making progress in its very measured scientific-based recovery in the battle against the worldwide pandemic known as COVID-19. On the 4th of May, phase one of Manitoba's economic recovery began. Critical public health measures and travel restrictions remained in place, but activities such as priority elective surgeries were restarted, diagnostic screening resumed, and some non-essential businesses were reopened. On Thursday of last week, the Premier released draft plans for phase two. These proposed next steps gradually continue the safe restoration of services and open additional businesses while ensuring physical distancing and other measures remain in place. The Premier invited Manitobans to look over details of the draft plan for phase two and provide feedback, and more than 5,000 of you provided your thoughts and ideas over the past week. As we continue to gather feedback on this phase two plan, we want to hear from you. If you have a question about phase two of our plan to restore services safely, please press *3 at any time to speak to a moderator. Again, that's *3 at any time to submit your question. Joining us this evening will be the Honorable Cameron Friesen, Minister of Health, Seniors, and Active Living, the Honorable Kelvin Goertzen, Minister of Education, Dr. Brent Roussin, Manitoba's Chief Provincial Public Health Officer, and Bruce Gray, the Deputy Minister responsible for Phase 2 of the Restoring Safe Services Roadmap. And remember, if you have a question that you would like one of these officials to answer, you can press *3 at any time. So, Minister Friesen, can you get us started with a few opening remarks?
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us. Welcome to all the officials on the call as well. My pleasure to be here this evening. I'll provide a few brief opening comments and say that, as you all know from the daily updates, Manitoba's numbers on COVID-19 continue to look very promising. Currently, we have no new cases. There's no one in a hospital for COVID-19. There's no one in an ICU. There's no one on a ventilator. And the number of people who have passed away from COVID-19 hasn't changed for at least a week. And that's all good, but I would say, as has been said before, that this story has a lot of chapters left to tell. And so it's been really the success of Manitobans doing the right things thus far that has gotten us to where we are today. Yes, Manitoba did take precautions. We put measures in place early. We acted to put restrictions in, close some businesses, and those things were significant. They were significant for families. They were significant for businesses who were affected. They were significant for things like churches and synagogues and mosques. They were significant for people going to school or university. But they had some effect. They helped to slow the spread, and those measures bought us time. And the time we used in order to get ready, we used that time in order to prepare our healthcare system. We started to wind down our surgeries, procedures, and diagnostic tests to be able to utilize that capacity for COVID-19 should we see a surge. We used that time to bring personal protective equipment, or what we all now call PPE, into this jurisdiction. That work continues, but we're in a better position now than we were just weeks ago. We used that time to solicit from retired nurses and other healthcare workers to get them back into the workforce. Our Minister of Families was able to retool our childcare facilities to get them ready to accept on a priority basis the children of people working in healthcare. And so where we are today looks very different than where we were even just a month ago. You know, a month ago today, we had 8 people in hospital. We had, at that time, already 6 deaths 1 month ago. A month later, really 7. And as the total number of cases has climbed slowly, the total amount of people who have recovered has grown much more significantly. And this is good, and it's the kind of story we want to tell. As a matter of fact, my special assistant and I just got off a phone call with the federal, provincial, territorial leaders of this country minutes ago. And I can tell you it's not the same in all jurisdictions. There are significant challenges, significant new cases in other jurisdictions. We have significant caseloads coming from places like personal care homes, and it's devastating. As a matter of fact, today, there was a master report released in Ontario on what COVID-19 has looked like in long-term care facilities, and that's a very, very devastating report, and I know there will be years of work that come from that report. I would say this for today. The numbers look good, but they have to continue to look good. So we say that we believe we've taken a measured approach. It's a balanced approach, and what we're balancing is the evidence on one hand that clearly points to the fact that we're doing better than a lot, and the ongoing need to keep people safe because we know the situation can change. The Premier has often said that this is a very sneaky foe that we have in COVID-19, and it can come back as it has in other jurisdictions. So, as our moderator has said, we did move to phase one, and now we've produced a document that would become a roadmap for phase two, and we welcome you to have input this evening. You know what the document says. Many of you have read it, you've seen it online, and you know that it talks about further restrictions being lifted, further personal services being allowed to operate, restaurants indoors, other operators, religious groups continue to be canvassed for input about how we can allow religious services to be reopened, and things like our rec facilities, golf courses, pools, splash parks and spas, fitness clubs, and many other things would resume. Film productions would resume. Day camps would resume. So we welcome you this evening. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for taking the time to have your input on our Restoring Safe Services Phase 2 proposal.
Thank you, Minister Friesen. Remember, if you'd like to ask a question this evening of Minister Friesen, Minister Goertzen, Dr. Roussin, or other government officials, press star 3 at any time. That's star 3. Returning life to normal for Manitoba's kids is a priority for all of us, and the draft of Phase 2 proposes increases to child care, day camps, and the limited opening of schools. The Honourable Kelvin Goertzen, Manitoba's Minister of Education, joins us tonight. Minister, would you like to make a few opening remarks?
Yeah, thank you, Paul, and it's a pleasure to be here with you and my friend and colleague Cameron Friesen and Dr. Roussin on the line as well. Over the course of this pandemic, we know that Manitobans have made sacrifices to help flatten the curve, and Minister Friesen outlined the success of that. Everyone has made sacrifices, and that's been clear in education as well. Students and teachers have continued to strive to ensure that they're learning and to ensure that they are teaching. And I've been very, very impressed with the professionalism of teachers over this time to continue to ensure that their students are learning, and also the compassion that they have provided. I've seen the parades that they've done sometimes in front of the houses of students to tell them that they are missed and that they look forward to seeing them back in the classroom. Of course, parents and guardians have also had to make sacrifices and have had to adjust to very quickly something that they hadn't planned. But overwhelmingly, I think they've done the best they can, but not in a perfect environment. So schools have been closed except for child care centers over the last several weeks. And there are teachers, of course, who have been going into class and retrieving supplies, and some have been doing videos. I spoke to a teacher earlier today who's been going in 4 days of work and has done 4 days a week and has done over 50 videos for instructional learning. And so there has certainly been activities within the schools, but now we need to move to a gradual reopening of these facilities. While classroom learning will continue to be suspended for the rest of the year, we are providing this access to teachers and students and day camps in the schools. This is about ensuring our students get proper assessment, prepare for transition and are preparing for next year. It's critically important that our students have this opportunity, as they are in some other provinces as well. So I want to again thank the teachers, administrators, parents, guardians, all those who have helped us during these difficult times. We're not back to normal yet, but it is an important step to ensuring our students feel a sense of normality, get connected again with their educators and the education system, prepare for school in the fall, get that assessment, and then get into summer. And we hope, of course, that they and our educators and all Manitobans have a wonderful summer as well. I look forward to your questions and your conversation this evening, and thank you for taking the time to be here.
Thank you, Minister Goertzen. And remember, if you'd like to ask a question this evening of Minister Friesen, Minister Goertzen, Dr. Roussin, or other government officials, press star 3 at any time. That's star 3. As Ministers Goertzen and Friesen have both mentioned, Manitoba's plan to restore services safely must be based first and foremost on the advice and direction of our public health leaders. Let's hear now from our Chief Provincial Public Health Officer, Dr. Roussin. Welcome.
Well, thanks, and good evening, everyone. Thanks, Minister Friesen, Minister Goertzen, and everyone who's joining us tonight. And I really want to thank all Manitobans for taking the steps to reduce everyone's risk of COVID-19. Manitobans have really stepped up and flattened the curve here, and really really proud to be a Manitoban. And so these last few months have not been easy. Been really challenging for Manitobans, for Canadians, you know, across the world. But really, thanks to your support and your actions, Manitoba has been able to look quite favorably based on our numbers. And we started our phase one plan. We're now essentially two full incubation periods into that phase one plan, and our numbers continue to look favorable, which sets us up now for safely moving into our phase two plan. And moving into this plan, again, businesses and organizations are going to have a distinct role to play in reducing the spread of COVID-19. In our workplaces, we've implemented these physical distancing guidelines, guidelines on hand hygiene, capacity reduction, limiting interactions to as brief as possible, increased sanitation, among other measures. And because of this, we've seen that phase one has been a success, and it's set us up now for phase two. And so I want to thank all the employees, managers, business owners, Manitobans in general, just for the strong and dedicated efforts to make this happen. So we introduced these strict measures 2 months ago. We knew we were against a big foe in COVID-19, so we had to act quickly, we had to act firmly, but we knew we were not going to be able to keep these measures in place for the foreseeable future. We have to find ways of living with this virus, and Manitobans have learned just that, and it's evidence that our phase one has been so successful. So this is all balance. You know, we're balancing the need to get back to some sort of normalcy, to get back to reopening our economy. We know there's much more to health than just this virus. We have other health conditions. We have our healthcare system that has to get back to seeing the typical conditions that they've been seeing before COVID. And so this plan here in phase two, much like phase one, is that balanced approach based on evidence, based on safety. And I think we've really put ourselves in a position to be successful again with this phase two and then phase three, and hopefully not too long of a future. So we look at a number of factors right now, and certainly we see that the spread of COVID-19 in Manitoba seems to be controlled. Our case counts are low. We haven't seen severe disease now in quite some time. People visiting our emergency departments for respiratory illnesses, that those numbers are low. One of the most important measures that we'll look at is the percent of our tests that come back positive, and that's been quite low. In fact, in the last 5 days, it's been zero. We have a lot of lab capacity, We have a lot of capacity in our healthcare system because we had the time, because we flattened the curve, we could build our capacity. So we're in a real good position right now to feel safe about moving into phase two. So we're going to continue to restrict travel to Manitoba. Our numbers are quite favorable, unlike some other jurisdictions in Canada. And so that's a risk to us to import this virus. We have to keep that in place for the foreseeable future. And we can move forward with this phase two. And it's a real broad approach, but it's a measured approach. It's restrictive in the guidelines that people have to follow. But I think we're set up in a real good position to move forward with it. It's certainly not a return to normal. Like I said, Manitobans, we need to learn how to live with this virus. This virus isn't gone, so we need to get back to some sense of normalcy, but by doing so, we need to be aware that that virus is still there. And so what are the big factors moving forward? It's the same thing that we've been talking about right from the beginning. And one of the biggest shifts is we can't have people with symptoms of respiratory illness going out in public, going to work, going to school. And it's that's a change. We've all done that. We've all went and battled through a cold before. Those times are gone. We have to stay firm on that. So employers need to ensure employees aren't showing up to work sick. We can't have students showing up to school sick. We're all going to have to do our part on that and just not accept that anymore. That's that the biggest change in our new normal. We're going to continue physical distancing whenever possible. We know this virus is spread within 2 meters, 6 feet of a symptomatic person. So if we can maintain that physical distancing when all possible, we're going to really dramatically decrease the chances of spreading this COVID. We know that the virus can be picked up on surfaces that we touch, especially if we touch our face. And that's the importance of washing our hands all the time and limiting the how much we touch our face. So, and then certainly if we are showing any symptoms, covering our coughs and sneezes. So it's really this new normal, but we've set ourselves up in Manitoba to be successful again with phase two, just as we were successful for phase one. So again, thanks to everyone for calling in, and really happy to answer any questions. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Roussin, and thank you, ministers, for those remarks and for your leadership over the past few months. That's very important. We are now ready to take questions from Manitobans on the line. First, we go out to Lorette, to Melanie, that wants to know about that June 1st date linked to schools. Melanie, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Go ahead.
Hi there. I've got a question. It's kind of a two-part question. My concern is that we did shut down schools for the last 2 months, and now for the very last month of June, you are asking teachers to go back in and some students. I realize it's not going to be lots. First of all, we don't know what this virus absolutely does to children. We've been hearing all kinds of different things. And second of all, we've got like a pretty good system going with online classes. I realize they will have to go back, but I'm wondering why was this call made that they need to return in June? And I do understand it's not full classes, it is smaller classes. Like, to me, I think we should be worried about the mental health of our teachers, the mental health of students. How do we get them to social distance? Couldn't this time have been put to better use into coming up with a plan for September? Why are we so rushed for this last month of June?
Thank you very much, Melanie, for the time and for the question. And it's an important question. The issue of safety, not just for children, but certainly for children, has been top of mind, I know, for the government, for the Premier, for our health minister. And we've been led by public health and the advice of public health officials, both when the decision was made to close these schools, but also now to partially reopen the schools as well. That is led by the advice of medical professionals. We've already had a limited use facilities for schools policy in place that was asked for by the school divisions because they wanted to bring some students back into the school. So that's already been happening for the last little while. We know in other provinces who aren't doing as well, like British Columbia and Quebec, they've started up classes more regularly than we are proposing, certainly, because we're not going back to regular classes. And in New Brunswick, they've asked their teachers to come back into the schools as well, and their numbers are certainly no better than Manitoba. So led by that public health advice, we then look at what are the needs of students. And we do know that there are many students who need to be connected back into school for assessment to see what has happened over the last several weeks to prepare them and their parents for summer to do some work to prepare for the fall. And also for teachers. Teachers have said to me they want time with students for composition of classes, for transition potentially into different schools, that is important for young people. And of course, there are many teachers who continue to go into the classroom during this time and to do work. And of course, when you look at phase two, a significant, if not the vast majority of Manitobans will be able to go back to the workplace, and to exclude teachers from that when the evidence doesn't lead to that exclusion didn't make sense. And so the balance falls both on safety and the needs of young people in Manitoba. Thanks very much for your question.
Thanks, Minister. And a reminder to folks on the line, if you'd like to ask a question, please press star 3, as Jim from Winnipeg did. He wants to talk about entertainment centers and fitness places and pools. Jim, are you on the line? Go ahead and ask your question.
I am. I want to know why you see indoor family recreation like bowling centers fitting into phase 3 and not phase 2 with other fitness clubs and gyms. I believe bowling centers can keep people safe just as restaurants can. So I just want an explanation of why they're in phase 3 and not phase 2.
Yeah, so Brent Roussin here. So I think it's a good question, and in fact, this is the document that you're referring to as a draft document. So we're still looking at a number of issues, and that is in fact one of the specific issues we're still looking at. And so we know that all of these things moving forward are going to have occupancy reductions. We're going to come up with guidance to ensure, like you say, ways to keep everyone safe. I think that it's a valid point, and we're still looking at just that, actually, just that specific thing we're looking at even tonight. So I hope we'll be able to communicate something more definitive in the next couple days on that.
Thank you, Doctor. Here's another one for you from Carly in Winnipeg. We hear all this chat about bubbles. Can you sort of explain what those are in this instance?
Yeah, and so it's a good question. And so it's there's a number of jurisdictions that have been taking this bubble approach. We haven't really paid much attention to the bubble approach in Manitoba, but essentially it is that when we're in the midst of community-based transmission, high levels, the safest place for you to be is in your home and your close household contacts. And so what other jurisdictions did as they started to lift those bubbles, they lift the restrictions, they started saying, well, now you can mingle with one other household, and that would be your bubble. But that would require that household to agree that you're their only household contact, and you to agree that you're their only household contact. So in Manitoba, we never really took that approach. We went more with the group sizes and then just advised Manitobans to make informed decisions. We never restricted, households getting together. What we said was the more contacts you have, the more chance that somebody in that group might have mild symptoms that could spread. And people who are really at risk of the severe complications, say those over 65, those with underlying medical conditions, those with immune compromise, then they had to take extra caution. So it's a valid approach. We just hadn't spent much time on it here in Manitoba. We're fixating on the group sizes and Manitoba and Manitobans making informed decisions.
Thank you, Doctor. Now it's time for us to ask a question of everyone on the call. Listen closely and get ready to provide your answer. Tonight, we're discussing phase two of Manitoba's roadmap to safely restart services, which includes increasing group sizes for day camps and child care services, providing limited access for teachers, students, and day camps to use schools, perhaps allowing sports and other organized activities to resume, easing some travel restrictions to allow people to travel to parks and campgrounds and cabins and lodges, and restoring access to pools and splash parks and spas, fitness clubs, gyms, and training facilities. So based on the draft phase two plan and what you've heard tonight from the ministers and Dr. Roussin, do you agree with the phase two plan, disagree with the plan, or are you still unsure? So here's how this works. Press one if you agree with the government's plan for phase two. Press two if you disagree. And press three if you still aren't sure or don't really know. Again, using your phone's keypad, let us know what you think about the phase two plan to restart services. Press one if you agree, press two if you disagree, and press three if you don't know. Okay, back to our calls. We're going to Wayne, who had a question about travel. Wayne, are you on the line?
Yes, I am. I was just wondering about interprovincial travel, like going to a cabin out of province and stuff like that.
Yeah, and so when we developed these rules on interprovincial travel, we started putting them in place once we saw that the epidemiology in Manitoba looked a lot more favorable than other jurisdictions. So we needed to prevent the importation of the virus. But we knew that there was a number of neighboring communities that people would travel to regularly from Manitoba. The case counts in those areas are no different than Manitoba. And so we left in certain exemptions in those orders. And so those are Manitobans traveling to nearby communities for routine purposes, such as visiting their own properties. They wouldn't be subject to the 14-day self-isolation. We do have those exemptions in at this point. And then as we move forward, we're going to continue to watch the case counts in other jurisdictions. And once we start seeing favorable numbers in other jurisdictions, we can start lifting some of these restrictions even more.
Thank you, Doctor. Next, we have Lois from Winnipeg with a question about masks. Lois, are you on the phone?
Yes.
Go ahead.
So my question is with regard to non-medicinal masks, as they're called, and I wonder why they have not been made mandatory throughout the province, perhaps throughout Canada, but certainly throughout the province of Manitoba. We've heard from many authorities that masks do make a difference, that we are protecting others when we wear a mask, and if everybody wore masks in grocery stores and everywhere, for that matter, in any store, not just the customers, but also the employees, it would certainly help to eradicate more cases of COVID.
Well, right, yeah, and so masks, the non-medical masks, so this had gone through a number of different stages of recommendation. So where we are right now is more of a permissive area. It's definitely much more important for sick people to stay home. It's much more important to practice physical distancing and wash your hands. But in addition to that, certainly people could wear non-medical masks. There's a lot of literature out there and that shows that, in fact, these masks don't do a whole bunch. It's likely that they may provide some protection, but they're certainly not, the jury is still out on just how much protection they provide. And you're right, they don't protect the person wearing them, but they probably can provide some protection to people around them. But we have studies, you know, even healthcare workers wearing medical masks who are trained to put them on properly, trained to wear them properly, trained to take them off properly, with relatively high levels of failure on them. And so it's, you know, I think it's certainly a valid thing to do. And I would recommend it to people to do it if they can't maintain that physical distancing. But we won't make it mandatory here because the evidence just doesn't support that that they do all that much. But it's certainly an option in addition to all of the other recommendations.
Thank you, Doctor. Our next question should probably go to Minister Friesen. It's from Sandy. And it's about churches. Sandy, go ahead with your question, please.
Hi. Yes, I'm wondering why we cannot open churches on a capacity level rather than a drive-in. A drive-in just is not conducive to church, especially with weather and so forth. And if we could open rather, excuse me, on a capacity level, would be much better.
Hi, Sandy. It's Cameron here. Thanks for your question. It's a good question. As I said before, you know, all of this is a bit of a balancing act, and there really is no textbook when it comes to how to be able to proceed. But your question is valid. It's one that we hear from a variety of areas. We see a lot of areas reopening. So people are saying, well, what about churches? What about synagogues? What about mosques? What about the ability of religious groups to be able to conduct their services in the way they used to? Here's what I can tell you. Right now, first of all, remember that there is an immediate benefit to these groups when it comes to the gathering sizes increases, as they did last Friday. 25 indoor and 50 outdoor does help. I mean, if you're a local church, you can have Sunday school Bible study, you can have a seniors group inside. You still have to do the right things, read the document in phase two proposal, and you clearly see that you need to create social distance, you need to wash your hands and have sanitization stations, but that can work. Now, beyond that, as you say, there also is this accommodation for groups, including churches or worship services, that they could operate outdoors either in their vehicles or stepping outside to the left-hand side of the vehicle. The vehicle creates the buffer zone between you and the next group. However, I'm going to give you the answer you really want to hear, which is this. I don't think we're far away from finding a solution that will restore the ability for churches, mosques, synagogues, and other religious groups to have indoor services based on occupancy level. I know that Dr. Roussin and myself and others have been really meeting with a lot of groups. There's actually a group right now that's tasked to go out and solicit advice from a broad variety of religious leaders to say, how can this happen? Now, I'm learning a lot from Dr. Roussin, so let me just add this part. Dr. Roussin is teaching me about aerosol-generating activities. So the reason this is complex is that Dr. Roussin says that the risk of spread increases when you have a prolonged contact where you can have aerosol-generating activities and you might be stationary for a long time. Well, that can describe a lot of times what happens. But you and I both know there's ways around that. Maybe every other pew, maybe separating families, maybe having smaller services. All of this is in play. I believe we'll have something to say before too long, perhaps before phase three, on a way where we can accommodate these groups and get things back to normal for these religious groups as well.
Thank you, Minister. A reminder to everyone online, if you'd like to ask a question, please press star 3. As Sam in the pod did, I believe this next one will be for you, Minister Goertzen, regarding protocols and teachers. Go ahead, Sam.
Hello. Thank you for taking my question here. I do have a question about going back into the classroom for teachers that may have pre-existing conditions. My question is why are students not required to wear a mask in school? And we know that it does reduce the risk of spreading it. So, like, why are there not protocols being made right now for going back into school?
Thanks very much, Sam. And certainly, I mean, these are discussions that we've had significantly with Dr. Roos and other officials within public health to make sure that our schools are safe for, of course, those who are entering as students and those who are entering as teachers and other staff within the schools. I mean, first of all, of course, there's going to be less people in the schools. We're not going fully back to school, so there's going to be a limited capacity. We've asked each of the different school divisions to provide their individual plans in terms of what they are looking to do to bring back students when the teachers and the students are meeting. We've been working with the school divisions to ensure that they have sanitation supplies. That seems to be going well, but of course we would advise any school that doesn't have those to not open, but it looks as though that concern is being well taken care of, and we'll continue to speak with them over the next few days. And then there are those, that advice that we've gotten, and we've heard it from Dr. Roussin and others, you know, over and over and over again, and these are things that Manitobans may never forget, right? Physically distance, stay that 6 feet apart. Stay at home if you are sick. That would apply for students, that would apply for staff, and that will should always apply, really. Wash your hands frequently. So those key guiding principles that are there within virtually every part of Manitoba society now, and will be applied within schools as well. So we'll have less students and teachers in the school at any given normal time. We will have those regular protocols in place, and then sanitation as well. In terms of masks, it is not being recommended at this point, but if there are parents or teachers who are looking to do that for a specific reason, then I would certainly suggest the teachers in particular speak to their employer, which is the school division, but it's not a recommendation. And we would not prevent a parent who has a particular request in terms of what they want to do to have that that applied to their child.
Thanks, Minister. Just checking in with Dr. Roussin to see if you wanted to add anything to that answer.
Yeah, and so I think that, you know, with masks, again, and non-medical masks, we have to ensure we understand their value. Like I say, we know that even with trained professionals in the healthcare setting who use PPE, there are breaches with it. And we know that using PPE masks in an inappropriate manner has many harms associated with it, touching your face, touching your eyes. And so to expect children to have strict adherence to proper mask wearing throughout the day is very unlikely, especially given that we see breaches even in trained healthcare providers. So again, I think that the masks are an option. I don't think it's a bad idea for anyone who chooses to wear a mask. That's certainly not what I'm saying. But they certainly don't provide the benefit that would make us lead to making them mandatory.
Thank you, Dr. Roussin. Well, now it's time to ask another poll question. And again, please listen closely and get ready to provide your answer. Tonight, we're discussing phase two of Manitoba's roadmap to safely restart services, which includes opening school facilities for limited access. This includes access for teachers to work from the classroom and to meet with students and parents one-on-one and for day camps and other groups. This phase does not include students returning to the classroom. So based on what you've heard tonight from the ministers and Dr. Roussin, do you agree with the phase two plan to open schools in a limited way to teachers, students, daycares, and other groups? Press one if you agree, press two if you disagree, and press three if you still aren't sure or don't know. Again, using your phone's keypad, let us know if you agree with the phase two plan to open schools in a limited way to teachers, students, daycares, and other groups. So press one if you agree, press two if you disagree, and press three if you're not sure or you don't know. And remember to press star three if you want to ask a question. So up to Brandon we go, to Katrina. who has a question about weddings and receptions. Katrina, are you on the line?
Yes, I'm here. Thank you.
Go ahead.
My question, I'm in the wedding industry. And so as the crowd size gatherings numbers have started to increase, and we've had some people that are wanting to move forward with weddings, I wanted to know if there's where we can get information on proper protocols in terms of things like buffet lines, bar service, how do we seat people properly at tables, is masks required, and all these things that come into play to safely host a wedding. And we're not finding a lot of information on the website as to what we need to follow to follow this safely.
Well, hi, I'll jump in first. It's Cameron here. So I would say this, that the phase two draft document does contain quite a lot of detailed information about what would be prohibited and what would be permitted in phase two. It does talk about buffet lines not being okay. It mentions that in a number of places in the document, everything from the film industry to otherwise, but clearly in this one as well, you are restricted in the meantime by size of gathering. When it comes to things like dance, as well, we know that facilities that have dancing are prohibited in phase two. But there's quite a lot of guidance, but of course, like you say, there's exceptions to every rule. So I'll allow Dr. Roussin to also jump in here and provide some specific guidelines for things like weddings and wedding planners.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks. So, I mean, I think it's a good point. You know, as we had our group sizes so restricted before, we didn't really need to provide much guidance on these things because they just weren't happening. So, I think we'll try to ensure we get some good information on our website for these type of common group settings to answer those questions. So, yeah, so certainly, wherever it's being held, it'll still have to comply with the other aspect of the order. So certainly, buffets are not going to be allowed in this phase. And then it's really back to those basics. So with the crowd sizes, we're going to try to have the physical distancing whenever possible, even indoor or outdoor. Seating, again, at tables, we wouldn't give necessarily the specific numbers at a table, but the less people sitting at a table, the better. The further apart the tables are, the better. So thanks for the question, because I think we're going to try to get something up on the website in the near future then to be able to give some specific guidance for these type of groups. So thanks.
Thank you for that. And remember, those of you on the line, if you have a question about the phase two plan to restore services safely, please press *3 to submit your question. We now go to Luke in Winnipeg, who has a question about healthcare professionals. Luke, are you on the line?
Yes, I'm here.
Go ahead.
Hi. My question is, we hear a lot about consultation with Dr. Roussin, a health expert, and I'm wondering how is the knowledge and opinions of experts from other fields, such as psychological experts, economic experts, and legal experts, also being taken into account, specifically to address the costs associated with economic shutdown and the government response to COVID-19. Thanks.
Hi, Luke, it's Cameron here. Thanks for the question. Well, I would say this, when it comes to the response to a pandemic, it is the actual express authority of the public health office. So there's actually legislation and regulation that defines the role of the chief provincial public health officer and of public health to guide response on this. That said, as the Minister of Health, I can tell you that the orders that the chief brings have to be enacted and approved by the Minister of Health. So all of these things are, of course, also always subject to those who you've elected to serve in the province. And beyond that, I would tell you that those other professions that you name are actually solicited for advice. This is a very, very broad sphere in which we make decisions. So I can tell you, and Dr. Roussin will speak for himself, but I can tell you that at the incident command table, which is the senior health table that guide the province's response to COVID-19, we are constantly soliciting from legal, from psychiatry, from other medical experts, from the chief medical officers, from the Health Sciences Center, from Addictions Foundations of Manitoba. And so I can tell you some of that input helped us to make the decision to engage to become the first province to provide an unlimited access online to mental health and anxiety supports through a Morneau Chappelle app that we have and a contract that we have. So that shows you the degree to which we are relying on a broad variety of medical experts. But as I said, at the end of the day, a response to a pandemic in the government structure goes to the public health chief. So that's part of his role.
Thank you, Minister. We now go to Larry out of Delta, has a question about travel and isolation. Larry, are you on the line? Go ahead, please.
Thank you. Dr. Roussin, I'd really like to thank your team and yourself for the wonderful job you've been doing in making our province a safe place to be. So thank you again. I would like to ask a question about if I were to travel from Manitoba to, say, Alberta, I would have to self-isolate, it would be my understanding, if I was able to get through Saskatchewan to Alberta, I'd have to self-isolate there. Could I self-isolate with the person that I'm staying with for the 2 weeks and then return to Manitoba and self-isolate again when I get here? Is that what the plan would be?
All right, yeah, so well, thanks for your comments and for the question. And so, Alberta, I do not believe has a an order regarding self-isolation because their case numbers have not been necessarily more favorable than other provinces. So they didn't necessarily see the need to have a interprovincial restriction. They certainly have the international one, which is done at the federal level. So I don't want to give specifics towards what would happen in Alberta, but certainly if you leave Manitoba and go further than what we'd call just routine travel to neighboring communities, when you return to Manitoba, then yes, you would be required to self-isolate for 14 days. And then on our website, they have a number of instructions on just what that self-isolation means. You don't have to be in a separate household than other people, but you should do whatever you can to limit your routine contact with people. And so you can find a lot of information on our website. But for, certainly coming back to Manitoba at this point, we're still going to require that 14-day self-isolation period.
Thank you. Rebecca has a question for us about living with roommates. Rebecca, are you on the phone there?
I am.
Go ahead.
Hi, this question is for Dr. Roussin. I am a student, and I am a higher-risk person. I live with a roommate. For the summer, I am not living with the roommates. I went back to my parents' place. Is it safe to go back to your apartment in the fall and live with your roommates?
Yeah, and so, for the most part, yes. We haven't advised that people, not cohabitate with anyone. But it's certainly the depending on the size of the apartment. So, we want everyone to, what we've been talking about is to do their part. If, if somebody became symptomatic, we would want them to self-isolate. And so certainly wouldn't be in a, if it's a relatively small setting with only one washroom, then that's not the best place to self-isolate should somebody be ill. But if everyone is monitoring their symptoms, everyone's washing their hands frequently, should try to limit close prolonged contact, and that's that 2 meter range for greater than 10 minutes, then certainly we wouldn't give the general advice to not cohabitate with people. It's just the keeping in mind all those precautions to take.
Marie from Winnipeg had a question about hair salons, I believe it was. Is that right, Marie? Go ahead.
That's correct. You had hair salons that give haircuts and hair coloring. What about perms?
Right, and so in phase one, we just, again, our typical approach, we're just gradually phasing things in, so we didn't allow those longer procedures to happen. In phase two, for places like the personal services, they're going to have the occupancy restrictions, but they're not going to have restrictions on the specific services. So that will be going forward with phase two.
Thank you, Doctor. From Caroline, a question about long-term care facilities and when might they be reopening. Minister?
Thank you, Caroline. So Manitobans know that out of an abundance of caution, we did take the measure that all other provinces took and territories, and that was to restrict visitor access to personal care homes. We know how difficult that has been for Manitobans. It was not a decision that we took lightly. We did a lot of thinking and a lot of planning to put this in place. We realized that we would need to be assisted by technology and other creative ways of trying to then reinforce how those residents were interacting with loved ones and friends. And, you know, heroic efforts were taken by groups, by facility operators, by loved ones outside. There were iPads bought, there were phone calls made, there were all kinds of volunteers who facilitated that. And you know, I've seen pictures of loved ones standing at the windows of a personal care home and talking with someone. I actually met someone yesterday who stopped me to talk about the fact that she had just come from a personal care home and visited with her mother through the window and showed her some flowers she was growing. Those are wonderful stories, but we realize that that's strain on people. Here's what we can tell you today. As of this Friday, we will be facilitating visits at personal care homes outdoors. I actually just spoke earlier with the Minister for Prince Edward Island, who says that they are doing the exact same thing in PEI. Now, we know from Dr. Roussin that outside, the risk is lower, so we can do that. But we all know today was a beautiful day in Manitoba when the rain stopped. The sun came out and it was warm, and we know that, you know, come October or January, if we're still doing something, it's got to be a more robust response. So I can give you this hint. Behind the scenes, while we will open those visits outside, we've got to do more, and we're planning for more about how we can increasingly allow in-person visits between residents and their loved ones, because it's got to happen. In the meantime, though, remember, personal care homes and hospitals, while we still have some restrictions on visiting, remember that those hospital and personal care homes can make discretionary decisions when there are exceptional circumstances. Someone in a hospice position, someone in palliative care, a child who is in a hospital, those kind of situations, someone who's gravely ill. Those decisions aren't easy, but they are being made.
Thank you, Minister. A reminder to those online, we still have some time left, so if you'd like to try and get in with a question, please press *3 to submit your question. Andre in Winnipeg has a question about testing and antibodies. Andre, are you on the line? Go ahead.
I am, thank you. Gentlemen, thank you for making this conference, whatever it is, available. I want to commend the Premier Pallister for what he has done, and all the ministers present, Dr. Roussin, Goertzen, all that have helped out in flattening out this curve. Of course, Manitobans as well for following the lead. To start with, let's all acknowledge a simple fact. This virus took everybody by surprise, the whole world. And we're still learning. There's still a lot of misinformation out there. But the one thing that we keep on hearing categorically is, if you feel the symptoms, if you feel ill, don't go to work, don't do this, get tested, stay home. Isolate yourselves for 2 weeks. Get tested again. See if you're negative. Well, this is where the problem starts. This is where, unfortunately, I think a lot of people are going to have apprehensions about going back to work or school and everything else. The simple fact that any and every single healthcare worker goes to work, or anyone going to work, and gets tested, and it's negative today, and it's negative tomorrow, there's no guarantee it'll be negative again in a week. They could be very easily infected if there is a come across an asymptomatic person. But if someone tests positive, then they stay home, come back 2 weeks, test again until you're negative again. Then what happens? So here we are, the case across Canada, across the world, U.S., especially the U.S., my God, 1.7 million people have confirmed. 100,000
I can start there. I think we might have lost Andre there for a moment. He seems to have cut out. But from the question I heard thus far, a really thoughtful question about the value of testing for someone when you're asymptomatic. And your point is exactly right. It's one of the things we've all been learning from Dr. Roussin, that a test that comes up back negative does not put you in the clear. This virus has the ability to incubate. That incubation period could be as long as 14 days. You could be spreading the virus without appearing to be symptomatic. I would say this, and Dr. Roussin can add whatever he'd like to add in, but I would say this, that we know that right now in Manitoba, based on the numbers that I shared earlier, no new cases today, no one in hospital, that the principal concern in Manitoba is not community spread right now. It is the importation of the virus from outside. And therefore, right now, well, we know in other provinces with a much higher case positivity rate, they've been moving towards a total open asymptomatic testing. Anybody can go in for a test. We've been trying to orient our system so that we could do strategic, targeted asymptomatic testing, maybe for truck drivers coming back from long-haul routes outside of Manitoba, maybe for pilots, maybe for workers who are working in places like meat plants that's in close proximity where a single event could take out a large part of the workforce, maybe in shelters, maybe in corrections facilities, maybe for people presenting for surgeries. Those are the types of things that we're doing, and there we believe there could still be a real benefit for us to be able to spot, to report back a test, and then to isolate the person who is positive. Thanks anyways for the call. Really appreciated that.
Thank you. We now go to the PAW. Sorry, make that to Thompson. Christopher has a question about the restrictions on traveling. So, Christopher, are you on the line?
I am on the line.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, I was asked, curious on when the restriction for travels north of the 53rd parallel will be released, so we can travel down to Winnipeg or, you know, be able to make some travel south if you want to do a cottage or such. Just, and what is the metric for allowing us to get back to some normalcy of life?
Yeah, yeah. So thanks for that question. So I'll just clarify one thing is that for residents of the north, there is no restriction. So if you lived in the north, you would be free to travel anywhere you want, and you'd be free to travel back to the north if you were a resident of the north. So that's how the order is always read. We've just tried to limit non-essential travel to the north by others to, again, try to protect some of the most susceptible communities. If you see in other places such as Saskatchewan, if this virus is introduced into a remote isolated community, then just like the flu, just like we saw with H1N1 of 2009, it causes a dramatic effect. So that was the idea behind that. So in fact, in phase two, we're going to be loosening some of those restrictions. We're not removing them totally, but we're going to allow travel to cottages, to cabins, to hunting and fishing, and again, trying to reduce the contact with large urban centers, trying to reduce the contact certainly with remote isolated communities, but we will be loosening it up to try, you know, to ensure people can get up to their own cottages or do that hunting and fishing, those lodges. So thanks for that question.
Thank you, Dr. Rubin. Unfortunately, folks, it's the top of the clock, and that's all the time we have for questions tonight. We know there are many questions that we were not able to get to today. The survey on engagemb.ca is still open, so please visit engagemb, that's all one, .ca to provide your feedback on phase two. After the call, you will be directed to a voicemail message box. If you have any additional comments you'd like to share with the ministers or government, please stay on the line and leave a message. So before we end tonight, Minister Friesen, do you have any closing remarks?
Thank you, Paul. I want to thank Minister Goertzen, Dr. Roussin, Deputy Minister Bruce Gray for joining me this evening to answer some of your questions. As Paul said, maybe some of you didn't get your question answered, but there's a lot of resources that exist online for you to go there and to ask a question and have answers returned. We do invite you to review our Restoring Safe Services Roadmap for Recovery Phase 2 document. It's a good document, but it needs the input of Manitobans to strengthen it. We are poised to take that next step soon to phase two in Manitoba based on evidence, based on the leadership by people like Dr. Roussin and our frontline workers who are serving us every single day in the healthcare system and across our province. We've done a tremendous job of flattening our curve. We know there is more work to do. Today, the landscape looks very different than it did a month ago and 2 months ago. And we want to see those low case numbers continue. We want to continue to see a decline in active cases and hospitalization stays. But all of that is up to us together. So we have to continue to do the right things. And we have to move forward in that balanced approach that we said. Balances on that one hand that need to keep people safe. And on the other hand, the need for us to try to return to normal, whatever that new normal looks like. Everyone, thank you for joining us tonight, and thank you for your compliance to keep going on COVID-19, and thank you for your excellent efforts to keep yourself, your families, and your neighbors safe.
Thank you again, Mr. Friesen, and to Minister Goertzen and Dr. Roussin for their time tonight. Please stay on the line if you have any additional comments you'd like to share with the ministers or government. Your call will be directed to a voice mailbox. And don't forget, the survey on engagemb.ca is still open, so please visit engagemb.ca to provide your feedback on phase two of Manitoba's roadmap to restore services safely. Thank you, and have a good night.